G'day, Dave here, and it's day five of our walk towards Christmas. It's December the 5th, and we've been looking at how God had a plan for Christmas. It began right back at the very beginning with Adam and Eve, and God's plan was to destroy the work of the devil, to get rid of sin and evil and death and judgment in our world. And it's a plan that he puts into effect through particular people, Abraham being the father of a great nation. Then you look at his son Isaac, and then his son Jacob, one of two twins, Jacob and Esau, and how God's line keeps working its way down until at the end of the book of Genesis, all of God's people, and they're a family with 12 sons and tribes, and they've become a nation, and they are now slaves in Egypt. And it's at this time that there's one particular person that God raises up. It's a boy by the name of Moses, who's rescued and gathered up, and he grows up in Pharaoh's household. But then a number of years later, God chooses to save his people through Moses. And there's this account where Moses is coming into the presence of God and he's treading on holy ground. And I wonder if you've had an experience of treading on what might be called holy ground. I think my first experience of this was back in 1992. I was given tickets to go to an AFL grand final at the MCG, and that's pretty special. To go to the MCG at any time is quite amazing, but to be there for a grand final, I watched the West Coast Eagles win their first premiership against Geelong. And after the game, people just flooded onto the turf. And I remember just walking around on the MCG thinking, this is amazing. Well, Moses comes into the presence of God, and God tells him that he must take off his shoes because he's walking on holy ground. Let's hear what takes place there in Exodus chapter 3. Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it didn't burn. So Moses thought, I'll go over and see this strange sight, why the bush doesn't burn up. And then the Lord saw that he'd gone over to look, and God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. And then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And at this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. See, there's a problem that Moses has in being able to come into the presence of God, to be able to look upon the face of God, is not something that a sinful person can do and live. And so Moses hides himself from God. The Lord said, verse 7, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I've come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring the people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. And Moses says to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said to him, I will be with you. You see, Moses wasn't really qualified to be the Saviour. Moses was just as guilty as all the rest of the people. In fact, you can read on and discover that as Moses leads the people of Israel through the wilderness, his disobedience leads to him not entering into the promised land. In fact, all the adult generation that left slavery in Egypt didn't get to enter into this land. Only those under the age of 12 ultimately entered the land with two others. Because you see, we can't earn our way to God. We can't make our way on our own terms into God's holy land. We can't come into the presence of God on our own terms. We're not fit to stand before a holy God. And so we need to be rescued. And the great news is that even though Moses wasn't ultimately fit to be the rescuer of God's people, God had always planned to send someone who would be. And when you get to the New Testament, we discover that the first Christmas is about God sending his son to be that savior, not to rescue people from slavery in Egypt, but to rescue people from their sin. And as Jesus grows, he shows himself to be the one who is without sin. He didn't do anything wrong. He always lived a faithful and obedient life to God his Father. And he steps in to take our place, to rescue us from God's judgment on our sin. So friends, this Christmas, as you see a tree, maybe a light, not burning and probably certainly not like this burning bush, why not remember that God sent a Savior? First of all, he sent Moses, but finally, he sent Jesus to be the sinless, perfect Savior of his people.